Well, I guess we had to get to this point eventually. Talking about good Doctor Who books is great. I get to share something positive and fascinating with all of you. Talking about historically important Doctor Who books is great. This series is just as much about the pop cultural importance of the Virgin New Adventures as they are book reviews. Talking about bad Doctor Who books is, well, I won't say great, but rewarding, since breaking down why something doesn't work can be both educational and entertaining. But now we've gotten our first truly middle-of-the-road, not bad, not great, not important, just kind of bland book with very little to say. If you're wondering why it took so long to do this video, well, there you go. This is Shadowmind by Christopher Bulis. New Byzantium itself had proved as fresh and elegant as her first distant view of it had promised. In fact, it was what people of her time would have wished a futuristic city to be like. Towers, spires, and domes that managed the difficult architectural feat of being both majestic and impressive without being overpowering. It thronged with people, but the efficient, powered walkways and sinuous, transparent travel tubes with their silver bullet capsules eliminated the expected crush of private traffic. Well, if you thought white darkness meant we were done with future human space colonies for a while, I'm sorry to disappoint. Welcome to New Byzantium, capital city of the planet Ternegyre, in the year 2673. The city is clean, pristine, stable, full of possibilities, basically a theme park, so it's a perfect place for the Doctor to take Ace on her birthday. But this is Doctor Who, where any attempt to take a relaxing vacation usually ends up with the Doctor facing off against some ancient unearthed evil. Case in point, it's not long after arriving that Ace witnesses a back alley murder, a man shot in the chest. Ace manages to chase off the attackers, but when investigating the body, she is shocked to see a small creature climb out of the open wound. When the Doctor examines the dead man, he discovers that it's not actually a human body, but a biomechanical exoform meant to appear human, piloted by the tiny alien in his chest. Which I think technically makes this book a mech anime. And this isn't just a generic body form, it's taken the form and identity of an actual citizen, which raises the question, what happened to the original person? After the usual runaround of being suspected of the murder, these three strangers did arrive without passing through customs after all, the Doctor, Ace, and Professor Bernice Summerfield begin to uncover a conspiracy where several members of leadership have been replaced with these perfect alien duplicates. Whatever's going on seems to have something to do with a young colony planet called Arden, population 5000, that recently discovered an old black mineral that seems to resist scientific testing. It turns out that everyone identified as a duplicate visited Arden at some point, and the Doctor figures that whatever's going on is happening on that planet. However, someone, somehow, has stolen the TARDIS, and an attack on the New Byzantium spaceport leaves only one ship for the mission, the CSS Broadsword, her rookie crew awaiting their maiden voyage. With the Doctor and his companions on board, it's up to the Broadsword to reach Arden in time and figure out what evil plot is forming here. There isn't much of an evil plot, actually. The big bad turns out to be an evil sentient asteroid named Umbra, which, oh, sorry book, Adventure Zone owns that word now. Oh, what if the Doctor's question mark umbrella was the Umbra staff? Oh, crossover, baby. Anyway, Umbra is using its telepathic powers to control the Shen, a small mammal-like species with a hive mind. It makes them create and control the duplicates for their own gain. It is basically a Monster of the Week story, a simple monster for the Doctor to face down and defeat without much commentary. The Doctor even goes out of his way to point out how childish Umbra is being. It just wanted to be one big growing baby. Baby? Exclaimed Kasuma. Well, adolescent, perhaps. It's very immature in some ways, brilliant in others, the typical product of a sheltered upbringing. Its appreciation of reality is, shall we say, one-sided and rather selfish. So that was its aim. It's rare to have a story point out just how one-dimensional its villain is, which does imply a bit of self-awareness from the author. There's nothing inherently wrong with a simple villain, so long as it serves a larger story goal. For example, Umbra is very conceptually similar to House, another telepathic space rock seeking to expand its reach into the New Who episode, The Doctor's Wife. There isn't much to House either, but his abilities serve the story in giving the Doctor's TARDIS a voice. House's simple nature serves the real point of the episode, which is exploring the personal relationship between the Doctor and the TARDIS. Well, I'm afraid to say that Shadowmind doesn't really have much of a point outside of its simple Monster of the Week plot. It's thematically shallow, and there isn't a whole lot of character building for the TARDIS crew. There was certainly potential. The first chunk of this book has a body snatcher plot where people in government are working for an evil shadow force, which is a recipe for explorations of government corruption, something the Seventh Doctor was specifically designed to deal with. This book got so close to being a Doctor Who flavored political thriller, with the Doctor facing off against a dozen Manchurian candidates. And what of the shining utopia of New Byzantium? If there's one thing you shouldn't trust in Doctor Who, it's a shining utopia. But the duplicate story ends up pretty slight. The Doctor figures out the Arden connection pretty quickly, and on page 113 of this 244-page book, the Doctor introduces a device that can just automatically detect the duplicates, so the tension inherent in the premise evaporates pretty quickly. And New Byzantium doesn't have a dark secret, it really is just that perfect. The back half of the book is mostly just spaceship battles and space marine stuff on the ground, which isn't new for the series, and yeah, it's just a Monster of the Week story with an evil asteroid. I mean, it's not bad. As a Monster of the Week story goes, it's perfectly adequate. There's some action, some things blow up. It's not needlessly racist. It's a good time at the movies, only it's a book and it takes a weekend to read. It's fine. It's fine. This book is fine. It's just, it's fine. Just, you know, it can make for a very boring YouTube video. So, let's go ahead and do the author spotlight while I try to pick whatever interesting scraps I can from the bones. Unfortunately, there isn't a lot here either. Christopher Bulis was born in 1956 in England and was a day one kid when Doctor Who first went on the air in 1963. However, his pre-Doctor Who career remains inaccessible. We do know that, on top of being a writer, he was a designer, artist, and illustrator, and even did the artwork for his own book, one of only two times that would happen, the other being Jim Mortimer for Lucifer Rising. His cover is, fine. Though I'm not sure about his faces, they kind of look like Gary Anderson puppets. Bulis also did the art for the Doctor Who magazine Prelude. Oh, yeah, the Preludes. I haven't really talked about those, have I? As part of the Virgin New Adventures promotion, little extra chapters that tie into the book's larger story were printed in Doctor Who magazine. They're never crucial to the book. You don't need them to understand what's going on. They're just a little treat to those with a magazine subscription. In this case, we have a story of Gerald Manton, the weapon technician on the broadsword, how he was thrown down a set of stairs in the dark, being forced to recover in the hospital, which is a bit of a setup for him being replaced with a duplicate, which is information you don't need. The book does a fair job establishing it on its own. As for the art here, I won't judge it, since a lot of it is lost in the splotchy black and white magazine printing. Bulis, at least for a time, considered himself an artist first and a writer second, and claims to have struggled with things he couldn't visualize. For example, Bernice Summerfield. While Bulis was writing this book, most of Benny's adventures hadn't been published yet, and a lot of the art featuring Benny hadn't been created. As such, Benny has the least to do out of all the TARDIS crew. Biographical information for Bulis has remained largely scarce, not to mention he's the first author of this series whose picture I haven't been able to find. The only consistent source of information on him have been these back-of-the-book author blurbs, which after a point just start listing how many books he's written for Virgin. Bulis has written 3 previous books, ha ha ha. Bulis has written 4 previous books, ha ha ha. Eventually, they gave up on that and just went with, Christopher Bulis is a popular and respected author of science fiction. Okay, if you say so. The one thing we do have is this short article from the July 1993 edition of TV Zone, where we can pick out a few tidbits as to his thought process here. For example, why is New Byzantium such a boringly pure utopia? Well, actually, it's a pushback against the gritty dystopias the Virgin New Adventures has been setting itself in up to that point. It's very much the sort of thing people in the 20th century would like the future to be. It's a cliché, but then so are the cyberpunk futures imagined by other science fiction writers. Hopefully, Shadowmind will bring a breath of fresh air into the future, and at least my people and places are nice. One thing worth mentioning about this book is that the supporting cast is predominantly women, roughly a 2-to-1 ratio, with most of the major positions of power being held by women. the prefect of New Byzantium, the captain of the broadsword, the broadsword's ace fighter pilot. Of course, in a perfect world, this wouldn't be worth noting, but as it is, this is a part of Bulis' shiny utopia. And since Bulis' shiny utopia is a direct response to the Virgin New Adventure's gritty cyberpunk aesthetic, it's not hard to read these respectful women in power as a response to how the Virgin New Adventures have dealt with women. I'd argue that it's not a fair assessment from Bulis, but I think it's how he's approached his worldbuilding. Something that quickly becomes apparent was that Christopher Bulis was just perhaps too pure and pleasant for the landscape. For example, here's his comment on Ace's character and her evolution into New Ace during the book series. On TV, God, what a character. But I hate people being pointlessly rude. I like to think that I'm a nice enough person and that I get on with everyone, although I suppose she's a reflection of the 1990s. She's loaded down with so much emotional baggage, and I try to lighten her and soften her. In the New Adventures, she can't keep up that sort of emotional level, otherwise she'd burn up. Guys, I think Bulis was so bummed about Ace's new dark and gritty reimagining that he wrote a book just so he could throw her a birthday party. Also, he makes sure Ace gets laid. Ace, wearing a nightshirt, stepped out and quietly slid the door shut behind her. She blinked in surprise for a moment when she saw Bernice, then smiled and put her finger to her lips. Bernice beckoned, and Ace tiptoed along to her. They sat on Bernice's bed. "Well," she observed, eyeing Ace, "you look remarkably sprightly for this early hour, rather like the cat that just got the 'it's just for fun' company, okay?" stated Ace. "No strings, nothing serious. Just, let's say he has a nice smile and felt lonely. I was feeling the same, so we cheered each other up. End of story." This is the most fun Ace has had in a long time. In light of this context, some of the things Ace gets up to seems in mockery of the idea of new Ace. For example, this book introduces Ace's tactical helmet, which is made from the dome of a black Dalek Supreme. On one hand, this is the kind of trophy you might expect from a former Dalek hunter. On the other hand, it's hard to imagine someone wearing a Dalek hat without them looking like a complete bellend. But even better is Ace's new explosive weapon. We've gone from a teenage punk kit-bashing explosives out of deodorant cans, and we've gone to a professional soldier, and this is what she's come up with. "Always be prepared," she told herself. She drew out a handful of white spheres of assorted size, resembling uninteresting boiled sweets. Choosing a small one, she popped it into her mouth for a moment, then withdrew it. Now it was a deep red. She tossed it down the street and hugged the shelter of the archway. The explosion was most satisfactory, reverberating and echoing along the narrow streets and pushing a billowing hole through the misty air. The patter of descending chips of stone was like a round of applause to Ace's ears. "They're grenades that you activate by putting them in your mouth. They're grenades that you activate by putting them in your mouth. Hey, check out my new gun. You fire it by putting it into your ear. These are called neonitros. They look like candies and are activated by saliva. Oh, Ace assures everyone that if you accidentally swallow one, it'll be neutralized by stomach acids. And we all know that everyone produces the same level of stomach acids at the same rate, right? You know, I'm less worried about that and more worried about the kid who finds one of your candies and keeps it in their mouth long enough for the explosion to go off. And what happens if they chew one? The neonitros are impossibly impractical and super silly. And I think that's the point. For Bulis, New Ace represents what he perceives as the cynicism of the 1990s. That what seemed cool and edgy for a time was really just people wearing dorky hats and throwing around exploding candy. He does this without actually taking away Ace's agency or demeaning her actions. It's like, "Hey Ace, you know, I don't agree with your life choices, but I love you anyway, and I've decided to throw you this birthday party, and the villain you have to fight in this book is really simple and straightforward, so you don't have to be super angsty about it." I know I said this book doesn't have much theming, and I stand by that. There's very little substance to the text. In the meta-text, well, that's another story. Shadowmind is, in essence, a rejection of the direction the Virgin New Adventures was taking, a rejection of the cynicism and gritty reimaginings. Oh, Doctor Who has sex in it now? Well, here's a healthy, non-judgmental, consensual sexual encounter between two adults. Oh, we're so edgy now. Oh, Doctor Who is super violent? well, we'll have a violent finale, but Ace is going to berate herself because nobody had to die if she had just brought a stun gun instead of a blaster. Now any author who has Ace use a blaster from this point on will be breaking character. Mwahaha. Bulis' Doctor Who is a universe where human beings are forward-looking and inherently good, where authority is just and evil only comes in the form of simple, childish monsters that can be defeated with a bit of cleverness and some elbow grease. Bulis' Doctor Who is Season 2 Star Trek The Next Generation. However, this isn't a farce. It isn't a parody of the Virgin New Adventure style. We'll actually get books like that later down the line, but I think Christopher Bulis is being completely earnest here. He's just super wholesome and nice in a way that doesn't fit with the series. It probably comes to no surprise, then, that this is the only Virgin New Adventure book that he wrote. After this, he stuck with the Virgin Missing Adventures, writing 5 books in that line. In the Missing Adventures, you can live out that pure image of Doctor Who that you developed as a child. You don't have to play with these new ideas that are twisting Doctor Who into something unrecognizable. This ultimately doesn't speak well for the book. As a standalone Doctor Who story, it's very slight and forgettable. A store-bought cake full of empty calories. As part of the larger Virgin line, a series written by mostly fresh-faced writers chomping at the bit to do something new with the franchise, Shadowmind only stands out in how unimaginative it is. As a larger commentary in the Virgin line, there's something there, but I didn't really pick up on it until I found an obscure article in a 25-year-old magazine that shed a little light on the author's attitudes on the project. And based on all the reviews I've seen online, no one else picked up on it either. It's trying to give the series a punch in the arm, but it's doing so with all the strength and speed of a sloth. Next time, the TARDIS crew go on a vacation. As we've already established, that never goes wrong. However, this time Benny and Ace are alone because the Doctor got lost in another book. I'll explain later.